Welcome back to STS. In today's video, we're going to find the area of the region bounded by these two functions. First thing I want to do is to label the functions. This first one I'm going to call f of x. The second one I'm going to call g of x. What I want to do next is to find out the intersection of these two functions, because that's going to define the limit over which we do our integration. So we begin by taking x squared minus 2 and setting that equal to x. And now I notice that I want to get all my x's to one side so that I can factor. So I'm going to actually subtract x from both the right and left hand sides, which leaves me with x squared minus x minus 2 is equal to 0. And at this point I see that I am able to factor. I'm looking for the factors of this negative 2 that add up to a negative 1. Well, 2 is a prime number, so my only factors are 2 and 1. And when I add them together, if I want the result to be negative, that means the 2 has to be negative and the 1 has to be positive. At this point I have two factors and I can set each factor equal to 0. So x minus 2 equals 0. That lets me know that x is equal to 2. And then x plus 1 equals 0. That lets me know that x is equal to negative 1. So the limits for my integration are going to be from negative 1 to 2. So let's just put the integration symbol up here. And let's just put the 2 and the negative 1. And now let's go ahead and do a basic sketch of what we have here. We know that x squared minus 2 is a quadratic equation, which is just a parabola. And we see that it is it is vertically shifted down 2 units. So I know down here at negative 2 is going to be the vertex for this particular parabola. So let me just go ahead and draw that in. And then I know y equals x is a linear equation, which is just a straight line where both the x and y values are the same. So if I draw that in, well, let me fix that. If I draw that in, it goes through the origin like so. And I know that from what I found out earlier, that the intersections are at negative 1, which would be that position here, and positive 2, which is going to be this position up here. So the area or the region that we're trying to find the area for will be this region right here. Now we need to figure out which function is larger. From the quick sketch, we see that f is the parabola and we see g is the straight line. We see that over the interval from negative 1 to 2, we see g is at the top and f is at the bottom. So that means g is the larger of the two. But let's just figure out, maybe we couldn't do the drawing, so let's do it analytically just for example's sake. So let's pick a point between negative 1 and 2. The most obvious point would be 0. So I'm going to take f of 0. So that's going to be 0 squared minus 2, which gives me a minus 2. And if I take g of 0, that there is just going to give me 0. Well, we know that 0 is larger than negative 2, so that means that the g function has to be listed first inside of our integral. So here we're going to list g, which is x, minus, and I need to use parentheses because function f has two terms, and that's x squared minus 2 dx. And now I want to distribute this negative to both of those terms, so let's just rewrite. So here from negative 1 to 2, I have x. Actually, I'm going to put this in a different order. Negative x squared plus x, and then that's also going to be a positive 2. Notice that the sign for x squared is now negative and the sign for the 2 is now positive. Now I can integrate. Keep my negative out front. The integration of x squared is x cubed over 3. The integration of x is x squared over 2. And the integration of 2 is 2x. And again, I place my limits up here of negative 1 and 2. We begin by substituting in the value of 2, or the upper limit, for each value of x. So I have a negative out front, and 2 to the third is 8. So I have a negative 8 thirds plus 2 squared is 4, and then 4 divided by 2 is 2. And then plus 2 times 2 to give me a 4. And I have the upper portion. I have to subtract off the lower portion. Well, I have negative 1 to the third. Well, negative 1 to the third is negative 1, but times that negative 1 makes it positive. So here I have a positive 1 third. Then I have negative 1 squared, again, makes that a positive 1 over 2. And then I have 2 times the negative 1 to give me a negative 2. Now I want to try to combine some like terms here. So I have negative 8 thirds. Let me fix that. I have a negative 8 thirds plus 6 minus, and let's see, I have a 1 third. And if I have 1 half minus 2, well, that's actually 1.5. It's going to be negative. So it's going to be a negative 3 halves. All right, what I want to do now is to keep or to create common denominator so that I'm able to add all these fractional values together. And that common denominator is going to be 6. So for this first term here, for that to be a 6, I need to multiply everything by 2. So 3 times 2 gives me 6. So negative 8 times 2 gives me a negative 16. This 6 is understood to be over 1. So this is actually 36 over 6 minus this 3. For that to be a 6, I multiply by 2. So this is actually minus 2 6. I got a minus times a minus, so that's going to be a positive. And then for this to be a 6, I multiply by 3. So 3 times 2 is 6, so 3 times 3 gives me 9. So at this point, I know my denominator is 6, and I need to add everything up. Well, negative 16 plus 36 is a positive 20. And then 20 plus that 9 gives me a 29. And then 29 minus that 2 gives me 27. So here I see I have 27 over 6 square units. And what we're going to do now is call up the calculator so that we can verify these results graphically and also get the decimal representation of this 27 sixths. So let's go to the calculator. Here, let's do 27 divided by 6. So I see that actually comes out to be 4.5 square units. So let's go ahead and put that in. So this here is also 4.5 in its decimal representation. All right, so let's go to y equals. In y equals, we see that in the first position, I have the function f. In the second position, I have function g. Let's go ahead and graph those two. All right, we know that the x values have to be between negative 1 and 2. So let's do our x minimum at negative 1. Let's do our x maximum at 2. And then let's graph again. All right, these y values are pretty long. So let's do y. Let's make y go from, let's say, 3 to from a positive 3 to a negative 3. So let's go back to window. So the y minimum, let's make that negative 3. And then the y maximum, let's make that a positive 3. And then let's graph again. All right, that's a much better representation. So we want to find the area that's captured in here. Now let's go back to y equals. And we said that the function g was greater than the function f. So we're going to put in, for this third location, we're going to put in x minus, and again I need parentheses, and I'm going to take x squared minus 2 and then I want to graph that. Alright, so when this graph comes in, we're going to find the area underneath that graph, because that there is the same representation of the area between the blue line and the red line. So let's do second and then trace. Let's go down to option 7. We need to make sure that we're on the black line, which is y3. And again, that's verified by the color. And we also see the equation x minus the quantity x squared minus 2. Our lower limit we said was negative 1, so let's put that in. And our upper limit we said was a positive 2, so we place that in. And when we press enter, we get the shading. And when it finishes, we see that we have the limits from negative 1 to 2. And we see that it does, in fact, come out to be 4 5/10, or 4.5. All right, that sums up this video by Speller Tutorial Services. Please friend us on that Facebook page and also subscribe to our YouTube channel. And as always, thank you for watching.